Former juvenile court judge Tracie Hunter, convicted of having an unlawful interest in a public contract.
I violated no laws. I did not secure a public contract. I did not secure employment for my brother.
5 years later, the case that was at a simmer comes to a boiling point when a judge upheld Hunter's six-month jail sentence.
Mr. and Ms. Deputy can take her away.
On this episode of Let's Talk Cincy, we look back at how we got to this point.
Tracie has been her own worst enemy from the start.
The conviction and sentence that caused supporters to take to the streets.
I believe her to be a woman who, if she did something wrong, would say that.
And what community leaders say needs to be done to bring the community back together.
From WLWT, this is Let's Talk Cincy.
The response to the sentencing of former juvenile court judge Tracie Hunter has been forceful, to say the least, on both sides. I'm Curtis Fuller.
And I'm Alexis Rogers. Former Judge Tracie Hunter continues to insist that she's innocent, despite Judge Patrick Dinkelacker sending her to jail for 6 months. This has been a nearly 10-year journey in the making. Here's a look at how the case got to this point. In 2014, a grand jury indicted former juvenile court judge Tracie Hunter on multiple felony charges for her actions during her judgeship. The jury was hung on 8 of the charges. Hunter was convicted of unlawful interest in a public contract, a fourth-degree felony. Investigators say Hunter gave confidential documents to her brother to secure his employment with Hamilton County. In December of 2014, Judge Norbert Nadel sentenced Hunter to a 6-month jail sentence.
The evidence in this case shows the conduct of Judge Hunter has really dealt a serious blow to public confidence in our system of justice.
While beginning the appeal process, Hunter remained out of jail and adamant about her innocence. Years of appeals at different levels of court began. In 2016, a federal judge issued an emergency stay on her sentence. In 2017, a federal magistrate recommended denying Hunter's challenge to her conviction. From state appeals court to the Supreme Court, multiple courts upheld the decision to convict Hunter. 2 years later, in May of 2019, the judge decides Hunter's sentence can be imposed, a very emotional end to court that resulted in Hunter being dragged out of the courtroom.
We will not stand for it. We absolutely will not stand for it.
As her jail sentence began, rallies burst across the city, even at the homes of the judges prominent in the process. A controversial journey to a case that continues to grip the city.
And from the courthouse to the jailhouse, Tracie Hunter has maintained her innocence.
Over the years, we've had a chance to talk with her one-on-one about the case, what she wants, and her message to the community.
And so God has taught me to stand. There's a scripture in Ephesians that says, stand, and after you have done everything to stand, you keep standing. And Curtis, that's what I do every day. I have people say, I don't understand how you're still standing with everything that's being said about you, everything that people are doing to you, everything you're being accused of. It's God. God gives me strength. And when you know you've not done these things, and when you know that you're not this horrible person that they accuse you of being, it's easier to stand. Because ultimately, just like God vindicated me, and I was declared the winner of that 2010 race, all the way 18 months later in 2012, just like he did it then, I'm crazy enough to believe, and my faith is strong enough to believe, that no matter what they do to me, no matter what they charge me with, that in the end, that my God will vindicate me, because he knows that I haven't done anything wrong.
Tracie Hunter has maintained her innocence all along. The claim that she helped her brother with a county job, she says, just didn't happen.
I violated no laws. I did not secure a public contract. I did not secure employment for my brother, who worked for the court for about 7 years before I was elected judge. Then they need to drop these unrighteous and I believe unlawful charges against me.
Many of the people you see out here have stood with Hunter for nearly 10 years, from the election to the juvenile court that was stained with controversy, to a trial that at one time had Hunter facing 9 separate charges.
It's very humbling, and I attribute this to what I call the God factor. That God has literally been at the center of everything that's going on. That's why 10 years later, 5 years later, that you still see a groundswell of support.
Her supporters say Hunter was targeted since the election, and she agrees.
That is a travesty of justice. It's a miscarriage of justice. And the only way to right this wrong is to dismiss the charges against me that never should have been brought in the first place.
Now, meanwhile, Mayor John Cranley and former Mayor Charlie Lucan are among many in the community who have said Hunter should not have to serve time in jail. Well, coming up on Let's Talk Cincy, having an unlawful interest in a public contract.
We talked to a judge who breaks down the charge for which Tracie Hunter was convicted next. Hello and welcome back. Former Judge Tracie Hunter convicted and sentenced for having an unlawful interest in a public contract.
We sit down with Hamilton County Municipal Court Judge Fanon Rucker to talk about the charge that looms large in the Tracie Hunter case.
We're prohibited from talking specifically about cases that are pending that may tend to give what our opinion is about the case, or even just talking about it in a way that criticizes or talks about what somebody else should do. But our Chief Justice and our ethical rules say that one of our primary duties is to help inform the public of issues that go on in our legal system, to give a better understanding to the public about how things work and what types of issues need to be addressed. So in that capacity, I'm happy to answer anything, but I do have some limitation on what I can say specifically about Judge Hunter.
This charge that she was convicted of, having an unlawful interest in a public contract, what does that mean to the average person?
Well, the statute specifically lays out the definition of having unlawful interest in a public contract. I don't know it from memory, but what a lot of times what happens, and this is what happens with jurors, when I presided over about 20 jury trials and I tried about 30 jury trials before going on the bench, and the statute will have a title, and the statute will be called jaywalking. And someone will be charged with, you know, crossing in the middle of the street. And they say, well, that's not jaywalking. Well, the statute may be called jaywalking, but what specific facts are required to prove the title of the offense is what has to be looked at. And so I think there are five different subsections under having unlawful interest in a public contract. And, you know, as one might imagine, it has to do with the public official not being able to affect or on behalf of the family members, have an impact on their employment or procure contracts or things like that. Again, I don't know the specifics of the statute as I sit here. I've looked at it previously. But what's necessary is to take a look at the actual language of the statute instead of just the title.
Are judges influenced by what's happening outside the courtroom? I mean, obviously, you are aware there's been a lot of public outcry in the Hunter case. How much does that influence, or does it influence at all?
Absolutely not. No. Well, actually, and I say that only half jokingly. As judges, one of our ethical rules say that we are not to be influenced by the public clamor. In other words, if a million people are screaming outside that we're supposed to, or they want us to act in a specific way, we're not supposed to be influenced by that. We're supposed to be influenced by the law and by our ethical duty to make sure that the law is evenly enforced. That's what the words of the ethical duties say. That's what our disciplinary rules require. The practical reality is, as I sit here today, I am an elected official. As a judge in Ohio, on the municipal court level, on the juvenile court level, on the Common Pleas General Division bench, on the Supreme Court, on the Court of Appeals, we are elected judges. So to naively believe that we are not influenced in some way by who we believe are constituents or people who we believe can support or oppose us or who can cause us to lose our employment, I think that's a naive position for people to take, even considering what our ethical rules require, and that is that we're not to be influenced by the public clamor in any particular case.
Curtis, that's such interesting perspective there. And of course, we will have more from Judge Rucker in a little bit later on in the show. But coming up on Let's Talk Cincy, a former juvenile court judge sentenced to jail time.
What both sides are saying after the incarceration of Tracie Hunter.
No justice! No justice!
Since the controversial incarceration of Tracie Hunter, her supporters have not backed down. The time behind bars just fanning the flames that have been growing since this case started.
WLWT News 5's John London has the allegations being tossed around from both sides.
Some of her key supporters have asked to meet with Sheriff Jim Neal, Bishop Bobby Hilton for one.
Because we just want to be clear on what can be done, what cannot be done. We are very concerned about the well-being and the health of Judge Hunter.
According to Hilton, who has visited her, she is in pain due to the way she was removed from the courtroom after sentencing on Monday. Hasn't been able to use the phone, but the sheriff's spokesman tells me that was a technical glitch and it has now been worked out. In the meantime, those close to her do not appreciate Prosecutor Joe Dieters calling her, quote, a dumpster fire.
Tracie has been her own worst enemy from the start. The reality is she was a horrible judge. Horrible. I mean, if you talk to anyone candidly that will talk to you, they will tell you she was the worst ever. So that's just the reality of the situation.
Pastor Leslie Jones has known Hunter for more than 30 years. She was in court as Judge Patrick Dinkelacker ordered her to jail. She protested with others in front of his home Monday evening. She did the same in front of former Judge Norbert Nadel's home the next night. She says the former judge's character is above reproach.
We see innocent people go to jail every day and then convictions be overturned. And I don't believe it, I believe her to be a woman who, if she did something wrong, would say that. She doesn't feel she's done anything wrong. Exoneration is what she's seeking. And I believe that if it means that she has to see it all the way through, she will, because she's a woman of conviction.
Her incarceration remains a flashpoint.
For the community's sake, for all of our sake, let's shut this craziness down.
Well, you just saw Bishop Bobby Hilton right there, and he's staying in very close contact with Hunter while she's behind bars. Now, he tells us, quote, Hunter holds no animosity against the deputy sheriff who dragged her from the courtroom. She does not believe that there was any intent to hurt her and appreciates how she was treated after that unfortunate event, end quote.
This was totally an injustice. We all know it. It was all political. Judge Hunter is a political prisoner.
Now, that was State Senator Cecil Thomas speaking up for Tracie Hunter. Now, on the other side, the Hamilton County prosecutor says he supports the conviction, but going to jail could have been avoided, he says. Here's our one-on-one interview with Joe Dieters.
African-American judges have tried to help her. People have gone over there and said, hey, look, we can help you. My chief investigator is her first cousin and said the same thing to her, that, you know, we're not trying to hurt you, we're trying to help you. And she just won't listen to anybody. So when she got sentenced, which, by the way, Judge Dinkelacker did the right thing because he instituted Judge Nadel's sentence, I called the governor and just said, look, you need to review your possible options with Tracie Hunter. And one of them, obviously, is commutation. I didn't urge him to commute her. But I told him to check it out. So he called me back with his chief counsel, and he said she has to apply for it. They can't just do it on their own. And my understanding from people in the city that knows what's going on is that she won't apply for it. So what do you do? She has thumbed her nose at the system the whole time. And now, you know, she's in jail. But I will say this, Tracie Hunter is a low-level felon with no priors. And generally speaking, they shouldn't be in jail. That's just generally speaking. However, I will also add this. If you take the attitude that you're wrongly convicted, that you're not going to cooperate in any fashion or do anything, you're going to go to jail. If she's never shown remorse, she's never done anything like that, and her supporters still say she's innocent, which is ridiculous. She's indicted by a grand jury. This is not my case, by the way. She's indicted by a grand jury. She was convicted by a petit jury in common police court. First District Court of Appeals upheld the conviction. Ohio Supreme Court upheld the conviction. Then she goes to federal court. Federal District Court upheld the conviction. Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals denied her appeal. So, I mean, at what point do you say, okay, gosh, maybe I should do something different, and she's not done it? It's really a sad thing, because we have, look, I have promoted diversity on our bench, totally. I've run campaigns for African-American judges, and it's really pretty heartbreaking to see this go down like it went down, because she didn't have to have this happen, but she kept pushing it and pushing it and pushing it. She wasn't doing her dockets, she wasn't doing anything, and then when criminal conduct came to my attention, I was like, I can't do this. I represent the Court of Common Pleas. They brought in special prosecutors. The Court of Common Pleas appointed two lawyers to do it, and that's what happened. I mean, she routinely refers to my office as racist and things of that nature. The reality is, I've never had race be an issue in this case, ever, and I never would. So that's just the reality of the situation. And then there were crimes that came to our attention. We appointed special prosecutors. She got convicted. She's gone through every possible court she can go to. The U.S. Supreme Court's not going to hear this case. There's no way. So it's over.
Now, we should point out that Tracie Hunter is also a pastor at a Westside church.
We did see a lot of her constituents at the different rallies that we've seen across the city.
Mm-hmm. Well, coming up on Let's Talk Cincy, helping the community move forward from the Tracie Hunter case.
Why this case is stirring up so much controversy and how to instill confidence back into the justice system. A lot of supporters of Tracie Hunter have voiced their frustration at the two judges who played a part in Hunter's sentencing.
We want to bring back Hamilton County Municipal Court Judge Fanon Rucker for the tough decision judges have to make in cases like this and the impact a case like this has on the community.
There was a report that was issued by the Supreme Court of Ohio and the Ohio State Bar Association in 2000, about a year before we had our disturbances here. And it was a 10-year study of the court system by the Supreme Court and the Ohio State Bar Association. And the first paragraph of that report said, perception is reality. Essentially, if the perception by the public is that this is not a fair system, then that's the reality of the system, that it's not a fair system. So all of these issues that have been raised and the dust that has blown up from the ground of these news stories and these conflicts and these very public disagreements about these issues has caused the public to say, well, wait a minute. If there's that much conflict in a place where the knot is supposed to be untied, where we go to resolve conflict, where everyone is supposed to be treated the same, well, certainly that doesn't give us as a community confidence that our issues and disputes will be given due consideration if here is someone who's part of the system who's going through the same thing.
Wow. Let's talk about a judge's discretion. I know that in most cases you're bound to what a sentence might be, but how much discretion does a judge have in let's say a case like this?
Well, there is in courtrooms, and I always say when it comes to power, power is the discretion to have some impact over someone else's lives. The discretion that judges have, the discretion that prosecutors have, the discretion that an officer has on the scene in interaction with a citizen, that is just an incredible amount of power. So in that way, what you're asking is what is the discretion that a court has? I want to say unlimited, but the court has an incredible amount of discretion. I know if I have a case, for example, and I've had this happen in the past, someone is in front of me, except on certain cases where a mandatory sentence is required. And there are some sentences where they're required by state law to impose a certain number of days or a certain number of months. But outside of that, and I tell people this every day, before I pass sentence, I'm going to have to decide whether I give you no days or I give you a year and a half. I have to decide whether right now I'm going to give you a $1 fine or if I'm going to give you a $1,000 or a $2,000 fine. I have to decide right now whether I'm going to order you to stay away from your family, order you to stay away from your friends, order you to stay away from your job, order you to get a job. I mean, there are so many open possibilities of discretion. And that's the way it is in 99.9% of our cases. The only types of cases where we don't have that broad of a discretion of what to do are those cases where they're mandatory sentences. So when you ask, you know, how much discretion does a court have? A broad amount of discretion. And where, for example, I took over for a judge, Judge Mallory, Judge William Mallory, in 2007, went up to the Common Pleas Court. And that created a vacancy. And so I took over in his position on municipal court. Well, as cases come through, they're stamped now that say Judge Rucker, because I was the judge when the case was assigned, and so that's my case, and so I make the decision. But previously, they said Judge Mallory, because he was the judge who was in that courtroom or in that seat before I got there. Well, now I sit in the position of Judge Mallory. So if when he was on the bench, he imposed a sentence of 20 days in jail, and now it's a year later, that person's coming back to me for the execution of their sentence, I have the power because I'm in the seat now to impose that or say, you know what, I'm not going to impose that. I'm going to change the terms of sentence. I think there's a legal argument that I can't raise the sentence. I can't impose more days, but I would have the discretion in those instances to change the sentence to something less than what was originally ordered.
You know, Curtis, I find it so interesting to understand the legality behind it all because there's just so many different perspectives. And of course, we'll continue to follow this story as it moves on.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thanks for joining us for this edition of Let's Talk Cincy. We want to hear from you.
Email us your ideas at ltc@wlwt.com. You can also see full episodes and stories right here from Let's Talk Cincy by going to the menu tab of wlwt.com and clicking on Let's Talk Cincy.